All right, let's get some deeper analysis on the U.S.-NATO relations from our Mark Mirowitz. He's a professor over at the State University of New York Maritime College, as well as a political analyst. He joins us now from New York. Mark, good to see you again on the show. 4 years of Donald Trump, pretty much lashing out at long-time allies. How much of a U-turn do you think are we going to be seeing, night and day?
Not at all. I don't think so. First of all, it's President Macron who said that NATO was brain dead. And I think people should have listened to that, because what is actually the mission of NATO? I mean, to me, it is not clear. If its mission is to counter Russia and China, then that's a good mission. But I don't think the European countries who were pushing that back against the United States leadership in NATO by wanting to create their own geopolitical sovereignty are going to be successful. The only way for NATO to be successful is with U.S. leadership and with the commitment. But I went and looked this up. For years, the United States has asked these countries to commit to the 2% threshold, and they haven't done it. And President Trump, for all of the tough discussions and all the issues that the NATO Secretary General is complaining about, that was actually a very positive thing, that he encouraged these countries to do that. Now, General Austin, who is the defense secretary now, basically used the word encourage, striving. That is not sufficient to encourage these countries to commit to the 2%. They need to do it, or NATO will be, in fact, obsolete, as President Trump indicated. The only time that Article 5, collective security, which you highlighted in your summary, has been used was only on 9/11. And Crimea on Ukraine, NATO did nothing. So basically, NATO needs to go and do an introspection to figure out what is its mission going forward. But clearly, the main threats in the world right now are from Russia and China. And only by collective defense and collective security can these challenges be addressed with United States leadership.
There is a lot to unpack in what you just said. But I want to sort of ask you, President Trump, perhaps the most sort of anti-Europe that we've seen since in the post-World War II era. So if I'm one of these countries that's contributing less than that 2% mark, is it really all that outrageous for Donald Trump to come out and say and call him out?
Now, look, Trump was Trump. You know, we're finished with Trump now, hopefully for good. And there won't be another era of Trump. We're going to get over it. We're also trying to get over it domestically. The things that he did, we want to move on. But remember, Europe has been a problem. European unity and Europe relationships with the United States has been an ongoing problem in foreign policy. And as I said, NATO itself is an organization. This idea of multilateral cooperation is very good. That is Biden's emphasis in terms of getting in the Iran deal and getting back to the Paris Accord and being friendly with our allies, obviously essential. But where do we go from that as a practical matter? And I'm still questioning what is the forward-looking, what is the strategy going forward for NATO? And I don't see that you're going to do that unless you get the commitment on the part of the European countries to be on this in a serious way and not to try to do their own plan. I don't think Macron's plan for a sovereign European NATO has any viability at all. It's foolish, I think.
Okay.
We have big threats in the world. We need to get together and fight them with U.S. leadership, I believe.
I'll get to those threats in just a bit, but you had mentioned the new defense secretary's words. You said you put them in sort of air quotation, like encourage. Is the usage of terms like this sort of a signaling to a return to the status quo? And will this actually prevent the alliance to sort of evolve and show the progress that it needs to show?
Well, I mean, a lot of the Biden policies are all not Trump, you know, to undo what Trump did. And that's their domestic policy, that's their foreign policy. But I think they need to forge a way ahead on their own to figure out what it is that they want to do and give the proper, and it's not just a matter of tone. This is what General Austin, there's going to be a new tone. Yes, there won't be this vituperative criticism, this mercurial behavior from a president, you know, meeting with the Russians privately and all these other things, those are finished, fine. But what's the way forward? And there, I think, I still don't see clearly what is the way forward. Yes, we're not going to be Trump. We're going to have a better tone. We're not going to be critical. We're not going to be hypercritical. But what, in fact, are we going to do? Now, the one thing that Biden did was to stop the withdrawal of the troops from Germany. That's probably a very good thing. But the question is, does the United States want to be an interventionist country in Afghanistan, in Iraq? What is the forward-looking policy on those issues, and how are we going to extricate the United States from those problems? And that one I don't see yet. And I would say that right now Biden is committed to dealing with the pandemic. He wants to put his package together, his relief package, and he wants to keep the world stable. And the way to keep the world stable is to have a better tone with NATO. I agree with that. But okay. I think they have to have a better idea about what are they going to be doing going forward. I still don't see it.
Mark, let me give you a hypothetical title, NATO's policymaker or image maker. With Jack, we talked about these potential problems that NATO's facing in the next decade, Russia, China, Afghanistan, Syria, Iraq. What do you think the biggest threat is for the alliance?
Now, the biggest world threat right now is Russia and China, clearly. Now, obviously, the other problems of Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, all these issues are very, very important. But, you know, if you look at Syria, you'll see that the intervention of Russia in Syria is the linchpin, the key to that issue. So I would focus going forward to how to challenge the rise of China in particular. That is an existential threat, I believe, to the United States, even though, again, on that one, the United States talks about, if you listen to the Defense Secretary, Pentagon, et cetera, they talk about that China and the U.S., or even Biden, are competitors, and there are things that we can work on together. Yes, of course we should work together, but it's not a matter of economic or trade competition. It is a world threat. Europe is part of that. But, you know, Europe can't take the view, well, you know, we're going to do our own thing and let America counter China and counter Russia. That doesn't work. They need to be on board. So if you appointed me a policy guy, my policy is focus on that. And also at the same time, try to figure out what the way forward is in the other disputes, which are endless discussions on Afghanistan, Iraq, what we do. We need a policy on that, but we need to be, I would put on priority list, China and Russia, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. No question about it.
Okay. Mark Gerwitz, always a pleasure having you on the NewsHour. I do appreciate
Thank you.
Thanks for getting up so early.
No, sure. Anytime for you.